you know, little Canadian boy like me, so that makes a difference too.
Oh, we're not supposed to be biased on this show.
We're not. I'm just picking them.
Right, well, this is the Global Poker League, and we have 8 months of action, in fact, coming your way. It starts off with all online matches, as I said, every Tuesday. It's six max. Every Wednesday, Eurasian heads up. And every Thursday, it's America's heads up. So this is the online arena, and we're going to be doing this for 8 weeks. Then we go into live play. That will happen in Las Vegas. Then we will come back to 5 more weeks of online action. Then we'll go to the playoffs. And then finally, it will be the final, which will be at Wembley Arena in London. Very exciting stuff. I'm going to throw to the desk now to our commentary team of Griffin Bencher and Sam Grafton, who are going to take you through this very next match.
Thanks, Laura. Like she said, I'm Griffin Bencher. This is Sam Grafton. You're here at the GPL in week three. This is the third match of heads-up matches here on the second day of the week. Tim Adams of the Rome Emperors against Sergey Lebedev of the Moscow Wolverines.
Yeah, they nearly said Moscow Marauders there. I make that mistake as well. Tim Adams of the Rome Rofflers. Yeah, it's exciting stuff. You know, Tim Adams, a real high-caliber cash game player, won a 4-max bracelet. You know, going to be very familiar with short-handed poker. Don't know exactly how much heads-up he plays, but very, very strong player. Picked probably by Rome specifically for this format. Great guy. Was a little bit shy in the first match, but, you know, I've been fortunate enough to play at the same table as Tim before, and, you know, he's a very interesting guy, real fun personality. So I hopefully will see a little bit more of that today.
And finally, a sick brag from Sam. The coin gets
flipped. No, I mean, I played with him. I had to play.
Oh, was that you doing the filming, too? This that's amazing. Yes. That's fantastic.
Yeah.
Did you play a big pot? Mate, did you talk hands on break?
He actually moaned to me that I was distracting him from his he said normally he didn't like to speak at the table, but I brought him out of his shell. But, yeah, Tim's a great guy and, you know, great caliber. And as I said, Rome Emperors, I think, you know, specifically went for him because of his cash game background, you know, honed to this online format. And, you know, as Eric said, very tough opponent in Justin Bonomo. The first time we saw him, let's see him get some points on the board today.
Yeah, and I'm excited for potentially some better camera work. I mean, the first time around, you know, his first few matches of the GPL, he had that big light in the back. He was unshaven. I don't know. I think we're going to see a different side of. I think he's going to get that scarf going.
And
I mean, Tim Adams is, you know, notoriously an extremely good-looking guy. So I feel like, you know, maybe he's just going to show a little more of that sex appeal here. But let's look at Sergey Lebedev again.
Sergey Lebedev.
Yes.
I mean, even Eric Denis doesn't know anything about. And he's like a private detective. He will track you down. He will hunt down friends and family. Like, if he doesn't know what you're doing, you are Mr. Undercover. Apparently, he's won a Scoop 2K No Limit Hold'em Knockout event.
Can't win anything live, though. What a joke.
Obviously, you know, we should say two high roller appearances at the recent EPT in Dublin and three WSOP final tables. So, you know, he obviously has a strong...
A lot of Russian money behind him, yeah.
Mate, he's got uncle buying him into high rollers. I don't know. No, but he has a background. Got run over by Nananoko in that first match. But, you know, he'll be looking to come out today and play and show what he's all about. Didn't have the rub of the green there in the very first ever GPL match. And, we'll see what he brings today. You know, big night for Sergey Lebedev fans.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, obviously the getting swept by Randy Liu is not the way you want to start your career in the Global Poker League representing, you know, your home country. But having said that, obviously this was the intention by Anatoly Filatov when he drafted Sergey Lebedev to throw him into this format. Obviously that's where his background must be. And I think that's, you know, the reason why he's getting a second chance here against an even tougher opponent, obviously, in Tim Adams. I mean, Nononoko, great player. Tim Adams, I think maybe a league above, and I think that he'll probably show that here tonight.
Yeah, but look at our prediction. Last time we were like, oh, Igor Kurganov, he's going to crush. Yeah. Igor's the best. George Danza doesn't know what he's doing. And we were proved completely wrong. So anything can happen. Obviously,
mainly just showing our incompetence.
Yeah, basically,
I think we should just be very
we're
like...
We're punting.
Yeah, not give any expertise or analysis.
But yeah, I mean, you know, we tend to have a little bit of a bias towards the European, North American players.
Right.
They're the players we're familiar with. They're the players that, you know, we've sat at the table with and have, you know, great respect for. And, you know, we've seen them in action. Sergey Lebedev. You and me, we haven't got the money to buy into high rollers, so we're not familiar with this guy. Unless he's playing a $75 ABI online in MTTs, I've got no clue who the geezer
is. And if he's not, and I don't have respect for him, because I haven't seen him, then I'm just like, you know, he's just no one to me. No, he's obviously very talented player. He wouldn't be drafted by Anatoly Filatov. So let's just jump right in, guys. Let's see what these guys are doing. And there's Tim Adams, a nice better angle there. Sergey Lebedev.
Griffin Benger with predictions correctly. Expected better camera work from Tim Adams. Mark one up to us.
And look, he's got a bike in the background and everything.
Wow. Is that a chandelier in Sergey Lebedev?
999.
Oh, it's good.
Oh, Sergey.
Loving it.
I'm loving it as well. Lebedev? No, it doesn't work. Swing and a miss.
Not so bad. Not so good.
Ah, this is great.
This is awesome.
Sharing so much with us. Obviously, much harder to communicate with the fans and the guys at home when English isn't your native language. So we especially appreciate the effort from native Russian speakers.
I will try to talk more than last time.
Aww.
Loving it.
I just want to give him a hug.
But my English not so good. Now call. Not very good card.
And we'd expect to see maybe Tim.
This could be really thin.
It's good.
Wow. But I'm going to be bluffing. I'll be bluffing a lot of 7x, 3x. Yeah.
Even 8x hands.
If I want to be betting a 6, it's this one or a 1 with a club in it. But yeah. I think it's fine.
Wow. Pretty out of line without a club in his hand himself, Sergey, or any straight blockers. And I wonder what Tim does with this part of his range. Looks a bit perplexed. Sergey repping pretty narrow here.
Mm-hmm.
Only really like ace high clubs, king high clubs that check back.
First hand, right, the big one.
And Tim Adams betting very thin for value.
Whatever.
And Sergey turning. Fourth pair into bluff, high-level stuff.
Prefer to have club in my hand if I want a hero there.
And suggest that we are going to see a hard-fought battle.
Yeah, great to see. Flop favoring Sergey here.
But yeah, he's repping a flush, or you could even go as thin as. And like two pair.
I think it will be easier for me to talk in Russian because thinking about English words and playing the same time, not so easy for me. So guys, sorry, English guys. Hello, Russian guys. Talk Russian now.
That's understandable.
Quarter.
If you didn't catch that, Sergey saying that it's difficult for him to be translating in his head from Russian to English at the same time as playing this kind of caliber of opponent, and that's quite understandable. So he's going to be sharing his thoughts for our Russian-speaking audience, both of them out there, or however many there is.
Adams z Banoma.
Fortunately, Griffin speaks Russian, so he'll translate for us. What did he say
there? I
think Банома достаточно агрессивной игрой сработала. Поэтому такие вот рейз-риверы, как мы применили в первый раз, дальше будем напрактиковать, особенно где хотим показывать некоторую слабость, ставя относительно небольшим сайзом, с его любовью добирать крупно, что мы тоже увидели в первом матче, когда он собирал флеш и ставил большую ставку по флопу, почти банк черну и overbet river.
That's a very, very good point.
Yeah, I agree.
This will be a mix of a better bet and a check.
Какой-либо момент. Но для рейзинга тоже слабовато, чтобы рейзить флоп. Вообще надо дать проблифовать.
Yeah, I don't necessarily agree with that, but...
I love it when you go for the more subtle humor, Griff. It's rare, but...
Basically, we are going to follow through on diamond rivers, club rivers, and hopefully hit a four. But yeah.
Did you say blanky, blanky?
Blanky, blanky, blanky.
Well, I love
that. Sounds like someone's cold. Someone get the Russian
a
blanket.
I think this will be a give up. Yeah. I often check behind that combo on the flop, but instead of it, decided to bet at that time. It's going to follow through on many rivers.
Хочется, конечно, как-то вас веселить, общаться. Немножко не хватает опыта стрима. Ждем, когда Толя Филатов наконец разрешит себе поучаствовать в лиге. Он, видимо, хочет надежно. Так, ну сейчас мы будем по школе Вовы Троиновского играть через рейс. Он мне сказал, что я очень мало рейзер флоп. Тут еще и какая-то попытка дешево посмотреть терн. Мы этому воспрепятствуем.
Good flop here for Sergey Lebedev of Russia.
Check raising for value, and he's off to a great start here, Sergey, with that creative bluff on the river. Perhaps a little bit out of line in his frequency, but Tim was going for exceptionally thin value with a third pair.
It's going all Sergey's way so far.
Yeah.
So far.
Just to remind you guys, you're watching the Global Poker League. This is Tim Adams of the Rome Emperors against Sergey Lebedev of the Moscow Wolverines. We've already had a couple of matches today. Randy Liu defeating Jungleman Dan Cates 2-1. And George Danza unexpectedly winning 3 out of 3 for the Paris Aviators against Igor Kurganov.
Ну, флоп все равно нам было лучше поставить. Многих рук мы могли забрать, которых достаточно эти. Здесь слоудаун. Так, что мы бьем на ривере? 4-5, 5-6. С другой стороны.
Interesting to see if Tim continues with his strategy of betting very thin for value.
Сейчас обсайзим, наверное, обсайз.
And he does go for it here again with third pair.
Похоже не на флэш, не на трипс. Кажется, что он ставил бы больше.
It's a decent amount of не так много. Floats on this flop.
Его.
Couple missed gutters.
Коли флопа.
Gonna be peeling a lot with
like
Jack 10 with the Jack of Diamonds type hands that I'm gonna have to bluff. So.
Sergey,
I think my hand's definitely a bet on the river.
Looks him up, and a bit of a momentum shift back in the direction of Adams. That'll settle his nerves a little bit. Tim Adams coming from a very strong cash game background, also a World Series of Poker bracelet winner.
Organizators asking me to talk English also, so I will try to do my best.
We appreciate it, Sergey.
Nice value bet from Timothy. Didn't saw that he will value bet 7 so often.
We're gonna start off with our first 3 bet of the game.
I think it's a good time for Timothy to start to throw at me. I don't want to call this hand so weak. So I think that.
I mean, this is a combo. Usually, I just call. Try to forbet but this hand. I don't mind 3 betting. This one.
Top class poker here. Really nice to see Sergey's thoughts now that he's a little more comfortable with the format.
It would be not easy decision for him.
Wow, he's gone for it. And this.
And there's not much more to do.
Yeah.
Other than to muck.
Sergey really sensing that Tim was going to take that spot light.
Timothy likes to throw bet light, but I don't think that he is ready to 5-bet half light also.
Correct.
sometimes you should fold button.
Apparently Sergey's speaking some Russian.
Pretty good flop.
Got the Danza flop.
Interesting. That's a good turn. Half to bet, half pot. Boards.
Yeah, so a couple interesting hands early on. Definitely some interesting hands, but specifically the A6 hand. I think it was the first hand of the whole thing. I mean,
what did the blinds?
Yeah.
Call for bad.
Tim's such a nice guy. He doesn't
river
want to say
it. River bet is pretty thin, but
on the structure, you can. It's a bad small size.
Start off here with a call.
Get some fives. Some king high cards. Some
turn will be shots. Close depending on sizing.
Flop here will check.
I don't think the six. Like the six is a blank because a lot of his sixes will be barreling the turn.
Can't bluff this hand.
7-6.
Can't really bet this hand.
9-6. 6-4. So yeah, I think he chooses wisely to check back that combo on the river because I will have worse kings, king highs, if I don't decide to bluff them basically.
Really big now. 35.
If he's going to be betting that king jack, then he's going to be certainly bluffing too much. If he's choosing that king combo to bluff.
Nothing good for me.
But yeah, standard hand anyways.
So Tim Adams showing a little bit more about his thoughts on the game. Obviously, someone comes out of that, you know, the full tilt regs. Cash game players back in the day, Greg Merson, Tony Gregg, you know, those guys that were beating 5-10 and such like pre-Black Friday have gone on to, you know, make an impact on the live scene ever since. Look him up, Tim.
He's going to do it.
He's going to look him up.
For sure.
Six slow roll.
Such a slow roll here for ace nine high.
I'll just get the sheriff's badge out. Let's see what you're playing, sir. Let's take him to showdown.
Yeah.
You're coming with me.
Yeah.
You're coming to showdown, Lebedev.
Get out of my office, Lebedev. Hand in your badge and gun.
Lebedev, you've gone too far.
Yeah, you're a loose cannon, Lebedev.
I'm not sure.
Get out of my office.
There we go. Thank you, Tim Adams.
I mean, with that sizing the river, he's kind of making his hand look like 10x. Thing is, being on the river there with ace high, I mean, you expect to bet a lot. You expect him to bet a lot of his draws on the turn. On that specific texture, I think. Like all his random gutters.
Texture talk with
draws with the club.
I'll take it later.
Imagine
but,
if Tim
just dropped to like... the river. It just makes it look like 10x and... It kind of looks hard for him to have like a 5x type hand, although I could be wrong.
Imagine if Tim just dropped a knock-knock joke now. Imagine if he just like unleashed a comedic motor. I think we should encourage that. Like maybe we should tell him on the break, text him on the break, and say, we need some punchlines. You know?
Yeah.
Comedy hour with Tim Adams.
Well, that's why I was so excited when the news broke that the wild card selection of the Montreal Nationals was famous Canadian comedian Jason Lavallette.
That's going to be
not
exciting.
A lot of you guys
can't
know.
Wait.
The celebrity for the LA Sunset, of course, being Aaron Paul, but you know, little known sort of Montreal local
niche comedian
Jason Lavallette, going to be really exciting for the fans out there.
Can't wait. We're going to start off by calling. We're just going to give it a sec.
Big
size. I'm trying to tune into Twitch to see.
Griffin and Sam, go on, say it. We know you're a fan, Sam. It's okay.
What is yeah, so it's going to tune into Twitch.
Nice.
Didn't mention us yet.
It's his first 3-bet of the match, I believe. So other than that, so poor bet. He laid out on me.
But not too much, like 5-5-5.
Sergey very lazy with his sizing, just finds one of the buttons and then keeps going until he runs out of
call with the
numbers.
Gutter. And the two overs to the nine.
Diamond,
we also block.
Diamond.
King queen.
Flush already. Even nine. Sometimes he has king.
I assume he's 3-betting.
I think. Probably check here games. With many hands. Also jacks.
Yeah.
Tim Adams, obviously, with one of the worst hands he's going to get to the turn with. Turning queen high into a bluff, understandably so. There are some hands Sergey would give up with.
He has nine and bet it for protect and check behind river. So.
Just correct go assessment here from Lebedev.
See the river and decides there.
Sergey going nowhere.
No diamonds.
Wow.
Hope he check his ace nine.
Is he gonna go for it?
Maybe I should just pull Marchese. I mean, I decided to bet the turn. I'd obviously prefer a diamond in my hand, but yeah.
Tense moment here.
I think Dimitri has a lot of bluffs here. The problem is I have to.
I actually don't see him fold.
He has a lot of gut shots. Check queen, check 10.
Wow, this is sick.
Flush draw.
Get like, I just don't see him folding.
He's flush draw.
Unless he literally has aces. I just have all the queen 10, jack 10, queen jack, and I prefer to bluff the ones with the diamond in it. Wow. It's pretty sick. Yeah. I just have all those gutters that. I just have all those gutters that get to the river, and I think I'll bluff every single one with the diamond in it.
Yeah, interesting hand there, the way that worked out. Tim controlling his frequency based on his actual card, saying that if he had queen jack off with a diamond, he would go for the bluff. Ironically, of course, Sergey has the one hand that blocks those jack 10, queen jack type hands around which he's going to construct his bluffing range.
Yeah.
And as a result, he may well have folded that specific combination.
He has the blockers too, right, for the jacks. Yeah.
Really, really interesting stuff there.
Especially because I like size up on the turn. So when he check calls turn, his range is just like much, much stronger.
Great hand for us poker nerds anyway.
So I wouldn't have been surprised to see.
Then 8 off. Okay. Now he's the guy saying that.
I wouldn't have been surprised to see a hand like Ace King played exactly that way. Specifically with a diamond, ace, ace, as well.
Limp.
But yeah.
Sometimes.
So now we are at the 600-1200 level. Sergey Lebedev with a 3-1 chip lead over Tim Adams of the Rome Emperors.
Right here.
Oh, wow. I decided to 4-bet 6-4 of clubs instead of peeling. That's pretty interesting.
Should have shoved the 10-8, shouldn't you, Tim Adams, you nit? Then we could have berated him afterwards as well. Griff. How great would that? We love a good berate. Don't we love it when someone makes a good
beration at the end of a Wednesday.
We like to berate people, particularly by match three. Our patience is
Completely.
Unless it works, of course, in which case we praise it. In which case we would have been like genius.
Oh my God! I mean, that's the great thing about a guy like George Danzer. You know, he comes out there for the Paris Aviators, just plays perfect poker, and you know, he's really balancing his range, and he's got. Yeah, then we're
making straights against top
set. You scratch our back, we'll scratch yours, man.
Yeah.
If you show us some goods, we're going to give you some goods.
Tim Adams, I'm just telling you, a nice tweet to Alex Dreyfus saying how good the commentator is, that would really help you out.
Oh, dude, it goes such a long way.
Yeah, exactly.
Then yeah, with the queen-jack hand, I mean, I don't know if he calls river with jack-jack there, since he is blocking my bluffs, but it's also with the jack of diamonds. Blocking the flushes, so I'm not sure if he would call.
Right, Sergey just overfolded queen three off. Not sure that can be a completely correct strategy.
But yeah, I don't mind betting like sizing up on the turn there and then like giving up on river. I mean,
I think I can try to raise this hand.
Yeah.
Sometimes I will raise something very strong and something weak but playable like this. Try to make it 44.
It's a good strategy from Sergey. He's saying he'd raise his very strong hands like aces or kings. So he's going to pick a low card hand that does flop okay. Can flop some flush draws. And picks up the pot pre-flop. Taking Tim off a hand that he had him dominated.
It's really weird playing on camera.
Enough.
See, I don't know why you'd fold queen four off, open fold it, and then limp 6-8 off. It doesn't. That doesn't seem to me like. That's just like you're clicking.
Because 6-8. No, because 6-8 can make straights and stuff.
Ah.
This is heads up strategy stuff.
Side of the rip.
A little bit out of our league.
The old straight strategy.
Since I haven't making the straight. 2.8x.
I mean, I'm half kidding, but I feel like you can continue on pretty effectively on like four or five textures, 9-10 textures. Like, what are you gonna do with queen four? Like, you're hoping to hit top or the queen, and that's good. I'm serious.
Well,
put
it this way. Whenever he checks, you win on all ace high boards as well. Do you know what I mean? When you limp in. Like, queen high is good. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. So it's a positional thing, too. You're saying that he folded queen four in the big, correct?
No, in the small one. He open folded it.
Interesting. Oh, that's interesting. Then.
And then limped.
I mean, this is a call, but he's playing a strategy. this is a call. He's been
something good, but nothing.
Yeah, I mean, he's been just like limping whole range. I don't know.
Well, short hand has some specific.
I mean, with 12 bigs, king 6, I think is
good enough.
King 6 off is
play a lot, like short stack.
Very close to break even, slightly winning.
20 BBs, 15, even 10.
Ace queen, double D. Gotta love the four color deck. I didn't know I was such a fan until now.
Last time I
diamonds
did it with
up.
Blue.
I tell you what, the way a lot of these guys play heads up, you could just 3x out of the big blind and you just print in money with any two cards. No one, these guys are limping so much and they're not defending at all. Mm-hmm. Someone like Smart is going to come on and just run someone over by adopting that strategy soon.
But not George Danzer. I mean, he's just unbelievable.
George Danzer is unbelievable.
He really is. Yeah. I'm still
here we go. All in. Tim Adams going to make the call with the dominating ace.
Wow. 8.
Pretty good flop for the Russian here.
Action
Jack.
Flop.
Come on.
Jack or 6 required for Sergey Lebedev.
Don't want to start.
Here's Johnny.
Oh.
Big double up for
like
Tim Adams.
It was Randy. The same.
Big double up for Tim Adams.
And we're back in it.
The big blinds.
Tim representing the Rome Emperors, who, let's remember, don't have a win yet in the GPL.
And of course, you're betting him. You just doubled up. I don't want to play big hand, I think so.
Sergey.
And isn't ready to shove his big hand. So.
Go on, Sergey.
Pressure.
And I think against a cash game player like Tim Adams, this kind of small three bet isn't going to be super effective.
But also, you can think that I'm tilted, trying to win right now after losing hand. Awful flop. Don't want to lose money. That was a good try, pre-flop. Now we had to slow down.
Sergey recognizing this is a flop that hits the kind of hands Tim's gonna flat with. Tim's probably gonna go all in with some of his ace highs and call with a lot of these Broadway hands like
bluff,
Jack 10.
It will be a river.
Connect this with this board.
Sometimes I can take it with bet on the river.
What hand do you think Tim peels the three bet here and folds in the river?
This is like a really weird hand.
So few, yeah. He's like 7-8, 10-8, he would stab. Like, ace-10, he'd probably go all in pre. Ace-queen, he'd go all in pre. Seems really hard to come up with a combo.
Wow.
That he plays this way and folds. Sergey Lebedev. Getting a little bit out of line for us, out of line. Obviously, that three bet's going to work some percentage of the time.
No, I need some luck.
But the position's reversed now. Tim Adams, who's been on the rack the entirety of this match, now with double the amount of Sergey, double amount of chips as Sergey.
And this is a situation where I feel like if Timothy Adams would have raised, that Sergey would maybe opt to shove for the 16 effective. With the limp, he opts to limp, and that death of a flop. For the Russian, just
huge,
not running good so far here.
Huge flop
in these head-to-head matches.
Yeah. And Sergey actually
might check raise for value to get it in. Yeah.
I mean, this is the
decent flop.
Biggest, strongest queen that he checks probably. So he's going for value. Actually wants to get it in here.
Start up for the call. Let's give it a second to.
Bad card for both opponents, really. Tim may not get the rack now with 2x pot behind.
A lot of hands I can win right now.
But he probably still thinks he has the best hand because assuming that Timothy would probably shove flush draws on the flop, so. It might not change it that much. What do you think, Sam?
Yeah, I think against someone like Tim Adams, though, he probably does like keep his range balanced by just calling. Like, ace-high flush draws, he's like just going to call because ace-high.
He's also never going to face all-in bets on the turn where he doesn't realize his equity. He's always going to be able to call again.
Yeah, I think
the pot's so big.
I think like Tim might be someone who doesn't have a three-bet strategy on that flop.
Right.
Like some of the players who really think very deeply about the game tree cut down the game tree and only give themselves a number of limited number of options so that they can be balanced.
What kind of instrument does one use when they cut down the game tree, Sam?
What's it called? CREV and PIO solver and stuff like that.
Oh, that's what they are. Cool.
And so, anyway, Sergey betting out for value, I guess, here. But if he does get called, his hand. Thing about betting here is that now you're sort of over-repping your hand a little bit. I mean, when Tim calls here, is Queen 10 ever good? Really hard to know. Maybe Queen X with a heart. I mean, you're certainly not loving it when this bet goes in against Tim Adams' range.
It's just going to be a shove.
don't know what I want, really. But not sharp, for sure.
Hard to fold here for Sergey. Adam's going to have queen X with the hearts. 6X with the heart.
Yeah, but why would he shove 6X with the heart?
Don't think he can bluff here.
Could be a big fold here.
It's deuce, ace 5, it's ace of hearts, something like this.
Tough spot for Sergey Lebedev.
Mate, hero folds against Randy. Maybe it's time now. Okay. Check our hand. Should fold now.
Very impressive fold from Sergey Lebedev.
I don't know.
That could be the difference between 3 points and 0 points here, because he lives to fight on.
Just nice, not blocking queen. Like, if he just has, like, queen eight with a heart, queen nine with a heart, I assume he's just going to be, like, over it and call. But I don't know.
Extremely bad hands.
Sergey Lebedev. In fact, I said 10 big blinds. The blinds at 12-24. Only 5 big blinds now, and this is going to be all in with the ace. Call with Tim Adams for the ace.
Having an ace is nice.
And
chop, chop.
This is going to run out of chop a lot of the time. But
deuce, 3,
ace,
6.
Chop it up.
Still alive.
This is the first of 3 matches between these guys. Tim Adams of the Romans.
Interesting, he chose to raise 4-3 suited. When I limped the 10-4 hearts.
All in and a call again.
I mean, I would expect him to raise 4-3 off.
That's nice.
Queen or a 3.
For example. But like,
we'll win it. Otherwise, Sergey will double up.
I don't know.
Lebedev.
And he doubles.
Big all-in for Sergey Lebedev of the Moscow Wolverines. King high, good enough. And Tim
nothing
will be
too exciting there.
Itching to finish him off.
This might be a shove and then a tough spot for Timothy Adams. But him knowing his range perfectly. He
Come
makes
on.
The call with the knife, king 5.
8. One time.
Sergey needs a 10 or an 8. Let's see a 7 for a swap.
Jack. It's good also.
Sergey telling us he's out.
Here's Johnny. I did it again, Sam. Did you see what I did there?
Even a stop clock.
Cannot lose more.
Twice a week. Big river card. Sergey Lebedev actually takes the chip lead after those 2 double ups. Tim Adams, who all but finished Sergey Lebedev off, he made that big fold, remember, with top pair, bet folding the river to leave himself with 5 bigs, and rewarded with 2 double ups, and Sergey Lebedev, now perhaps the slight favorite, to take this match down. Absolutely incredible turn of events.
Catch quite often. Hope we'll check all time. All right, we'll catch my king.
Tim Adams. Excellent stuff. Delayed his bluff until the river.
Step the jack 5. Since trying to make him fold out ASI, basically.
Not my favorite hand, to be truth.
Seven Dewey, don't be spewy.
Seven Is that what you put on your audition tape? You send it into Dreyfus. Yeah. You like.
Well, me jacking off and the Dewey Suey.
Yeah, with the King Jack. I mean, I could check back, but I just kind of have like an auto bet on that board.
Sometimes you can raise and like this. He's calling his all in.
We will peel the 7-9.
Tim Adams taking Sergey to the streets again and again. I just want to recap about that hero fold. You know, it was a tough spot for Sergey Lebedev. Mm-hmm. Frustrating to, you know, flop a super strong top pair and have to fold it. But, you know, amazing. You know, if he makes that call there, he is out.
Combo with the diamond and the nine.
Unless
and seven,
we deal two more cards.
Yeah.
Unless you find the famous sixth river card. But, you know, here they are battling it out, and he's back to the chip lead. And, you know, shows that perhaps for some people newer to poker, the importance of, you know, making big folds.
Yeah, it's something that I've really appreciate, come to appreciate from the GPL.
I mean,
the
these
guys
boards were just like flopping top two and just blocking.
Find a way to, really keep themselves in the tournament, valuing their tournament.
I just have like an
we talked a lot about Tyler Kenny, the way he was able to keep in with
like
the ace deuce suited, min raise folding on like 11 bigs. So it's really interesting to see the strategies of the people that find a way to survive, as opposed to the button clicking you and I are used to online.
Just
3-bet folding, 20 bigs with ace jack suited, etc. Pretty fascinating stuff to watch.
Punting it off and just firing up another turbo.
Yeah, exactly. It's the only way to live, baby. I mean, it clearly isn't, actually. As a matter of fact, they're living a little bit better than us.
And Tim actually flopping a few big hands here. Top two, and then an overpair.
What a spoiled brat. You guys are just tuning in. Please follow the conversation at GPL on Twitter. If you have any complaints about anything you see, that's at Squid Poker. That's my partner Sam Grafton. Any complaints? any compliments? Pardon me. It's at Griffin Benger. I'm available any time of the day for compliments. I mean, I'll wake up in the middle of the night. I have a notification thing like a filter that's filters out the bad stuff. I'm very insecure and sensitive. But please check out www.globalpokerleague.com for standings, analysis, some video replays. But for now, let's see if Sergey Lebedev is going to win pot with nines. So far, so good.
Tim does catch a little piece here.
Oh, wow. He folded queen 10 there.
Set of sixes against my top pair.
Sergey getting the
Sergey getting a little confidence, a little swagger back with that. How Sergey got his groove back.
Better bet small one here.
You can sweep him under the rug all you want, Randy Lou. But he'll come back.
What a star is Randy Lou, hey?
Free.
Yeah.
Loving the old Art. Randy Lou.
Yeah.
He was so happy today.
Yeah.
And I think the tough thing about this, I mean, he does have a lot of draws, Sergey Lebedev. Actually looks like he's going to fold Tim off the worst hands. It's better to check there.
Did you know that Lebedev's poker star's name online is Mizakant? Interesting factoid.
Come
that
on,
means musician, written in phonetic Russian. Hashtag the more you know. Thanks for that, GPL. Coming straight from the horse's mouth in the Twitch chat.
So we can try to raise one more time.
And this is a bad spot for Tim Adams.
7-7-7-7.
Because he's seen him do this raise with 3-4 suiteds. And Tim Adams,
at least going to call, might shove.
You wouldn't blame him for shoving. I mean, Tim is a cash game player, and he likes to see flops.
He's got the jack and in. King jack suited.
This is pretty.
You can do it.
Close to just peeling.
And Tim Adams now will need
a
king or backdoor clubs, otherwise Sergey Lebedev will win.
Please. No flash, no king, just 7.
Lebedev.
No.
Wow, on the river. Tim Adams going wild. Look at the emotion on this man's face. Tim Adams.
I wasn't sure if he made a full house.
Tim Adams not quite able to read the board. And Sergey Lebedev has one ante here.
6.
But he does take the lead on the flop. And straight on the turn for Tim Adams. Still calling in cards. Such heartless geezer.
GG.
But Tim
luck again.
Adams wins it for the Rome Emperors.
Hey guys, welcome back to the desk. I'm Griffin Benger. This is Sam Grafton. That's Sergey Lebedev getting unlucky once again. He's 0 for 4 in the GPL, even though he's playing super, super well.
Yeah, really unfortunate for Sergey. You know, this match really revolved around one huge fold for Sergey Lebedev. Had the queen 10 when Timothy Adams limped in with pocket sixes, flopped a set. He managed to get away from that hand on the turn. You know, some people have sort of too much pride to make a fold, leaving 15 big blinds out there and leaving themselves with just five. He, you know, thought through the strategy, said that he didn't make any big folds to Randy Liu. Now was the time to make a hero fold. Was proved absolutely right. Fought back into the match, got it in ahead, covering Tim Adams, queens against King Jack suited. But as we see time and time again, there is a huge luck factor in poker. Tim Adams made that flush on the river, and he'll be super pleased to pick up 3 points for the Rome Emperors.
Yeah, can we talk a little bit about, I mean, I think how much Sergey Lebedev impressed us in this match. I mean, it wasn't just the big fold with the queen 10. It was the 4-bet preflop with the 6-4 suited. It was the raise on the river when he felt that Tim Adams was betting too thin with that ace 6 against Lebedev's 9-5 on the 6-5-4 jack 10. I mean, this is a guy that really knows his stuff, and this is obviously his specialty. So, again, you know, I understand he's 0-4 in the GPL, but based from where I'm sitting, I think that he's might be one of the best heads-up players in this format. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, one of the things that's interesting about it is it's such a traditionally Russian style. We think of them as very, very aggressive players. You know, he picked very aggressive strategies, making a pretty out-of-line river raise did work, making an unconventional fallback with 6-4 suited, and it did work also. So lots more to come from Sergey Lebedev. Look forward to seeing more of him in these next two matches. But I think we're going to go over to the lounge now and check in with Laura and Eric, who can tell us a little bit about where that win for Tim Adams leaves us in the standings.
Yeah, guys, what's going on?
Thanks, boys. Rome Emperors picking up 3 valuable points there. They need those points. And Tim Adams could be on his way to a win. Could.
Well, let's hope so. Well on his way right now, but he's going to need one of these next two matches. What a match here. Back and forth, back and forth.
Back and forth, yeah.
Very evenly matched.
Like a yo-yo.
It was, yes. Like a yo-yo. Little 80s reference, Laura. Or 70s or 60s. But yeah, really doing well. Really doing well on both sides. And again, a great match. Very evenly matched. It was a fun match to watch.
It was indeed. And now we've seen Lebedev play before. We've seen Adams play before. Did they show anything different in this match to what they've shown before previously?
No, I think both very solid players, and I think they're playing that same style. What's amazing is that Sergey Lebedev is 0 for 4, and yet he does seem to have a lot of skills. So we'll have to see. I mean, this is a guy that final table the one drop this summer. So obviously there's a lot of great skill there, a W Coupe win as well. So, you know, very accomplished player. It's just that we might not know as much about him as we do Tim Adams, for example, a bracelet winner himself. So it'll be intriguing to see what happens in this next match. But Lebedev is now showing a lot of color on air too, which is great.
Yeah, a lot more than he did the first time.
Very much so.
Although some of it in Russian, which I can't understand.
Right.
But
you wonder if, in his mind, he understood what Nananoko was going to do, so he just said, nah, screw it. You know, it's going to be a big show on the other side, so I'll just let him do what he's got to do for the whole match. But it was fun to see Lebedev get into it, and he's, Anatoly Filatov, through his Twitch channel, is hosting this match in Russian as well, so that's why we saw the multilingual aspect of the GPL.
The penultimate hand, though, it was a bit of a cooler for Lebedev. I did feel bad for him there, that the club's running out there.
Yeah, it was pretty rough way to end. That didn't end the match, but it basically put him on one blind.
Yeah.
You know, that was almost it. I think we saw Tyler Kenny come back from one or two blinds yesterday, so never say never.
It wasn't quite that little, was it?
It was quite little,
yeah. That was the ultimate comeback yesterday,
that's
wasn't
right.
It? Tyler Kenny, he did it like 3 times, I think.
Yeah, for sure. No, yeah, Tyler Kenny had a good night last night, so maybe Lebedev builds on that. Didn't work this time, but in a few minutes he comes back and gains some points for the Wolverines.
So Rome Emperors now have 3 additional points. They could make it 9 additional points if they do win the next 2 games in this match. Whether Lebedev will let Timothy Adams do that, I don't know. We'll have to wait and find out. But if Rome were to get the 9 points, would that fly them up any spots?
They would be secured in third, actually, if they do that. If they win one match, they'll go up to third right now. But Moscow would have the chance to to surpass them. But if they do win this next match, they do surpass London and Moscow in the standings. So, yes, yeah, suddenly the Emperor is looking good, and that would make the, that would guarantee them their first win as well. So, you know, not bad to see.
Because Moscow are in third place right now.
With 29 right? points, yeah. Right.
Right, let's take a look at some tweets that you guys have been sending in. There's been some good ones, in fact, some of the players and some of the managers. Oh, this is for the game earlier. Chris Moneymaker, obviously the manager of the Moneymakers. Jack 3, oh, that's going back to that hand that Nananoko made a bit of a boo-boo on. I can't wait to get me some GPL hashtag, gold daily hashtag, I secretly root for you.
We should not be shocked if we see a Moneymaker Las Vegas versus Nananoko Hong Kong live match in Las Vegas this summer. They go at each other quite a bit, but in all in fun. Moneymaker, who's recently new to Twitch, loving it, but does get it, you know, him and Lou are attacking themselves, or attacking each other on Twitter quite a bit, but all in fun, of course.
Okay, and we have one from Selena Lin, manager of the Hong Kong Stars. Chris Moneymaker, are you becoming a Hong Kong Stars fan?
Well, I think that would be a good thing, right? Hong Kong is riding high, second in the Eurasian Conference, and you're not playing the other conference
a lot. I guess at this point, they can be a fan of a team in the other conference. It's just they need to start worrying when those conferences join together.
And if you're Chris Moneymaker, new to Twitch, you must be very jealous when you see Nananoko getting all those purple hearts left and right on the stream. So maybe he's trying to get some of those, right?
Send me some purple hearts. Elke also sending us a tweet in early on. Awesome job at the GPL for the Paris Aviators. Tricky Scarfy, who is George Danza. You proved us all you can play Nolo Mahonam. How does it feel? Kappa, hashtag, so sick.
Yeah, Elke and the rest of the gang, really happy, really excited for George Danzer. We talked about it during the George interview, actually, with George, obviously, since he was part of that interview. But we talked about the camaraderie and how Fab Sewell making his team selections, that was the number one priority for him. He did not pick two, three big names in France, and that did create a lot of controversy. And Fab Sewell knew that that would create that controversy, but he preferred someone like Danzer, someone like Mike Lea, who are just team, you know, team players and really were committed to the league, actually would reach out to every manager saying, I'll play for you. Mike Lea, which is sort of funny, the Toronto guy playing for Paris, but he basically said, I'll play for anyone. He's got a little French bulldog that is now the team mascot, so Paris really sticking together, which is great to see.
I think he's done a good job picking George Danzer and picking Mike Lea, both great players and have proved themselves pretty well so far in the GPL. We're going to head back to the desk. That next game is coming up next. Who is going to take this? Of course, Lebedev wants it. Timothy Adams got the first one. Who will get this next one? Over to you, boys.
Thanks, Laura. This is Sam. I'm Griffin. You're at the GPL. Sergey Lebedev of the Moscow Wolverines. Tim Adams of the Rome Emperors. What do you think so far?
Yeah, really exciting stuff. I mean, we're beginning to take it for granted with so many great players coming on the GPL, but we should just remind viewers tuning in for the first or second time of the incredible caliber of players across the GPL. We're talking about Sergey Lebedev here, who, you know, when we place him against someone like Igor Kurganov, who's number one on the Russia's all-time list, doesn't seem like huge achievements, but this is a man with three WSOP final tables, final table the 10K and the 25K at the most recent EPT in Dublin. So huge, hugely strong poker background there. Tim Adams, someone that has crushed high stakes cash games on the internet, as I say time and time again, amongst the poker community, almost the most respect is reserved for those that can beat online cash games. Widely considered the toughest form of poker that there is, and someone that has a WSOP bracelet in a 4MAX event. Again, you know, four players at the table, somewhere where there's absolutely nowhere to hide, your poker skills really exposed, your poker skills really put to the test. So, you know, we're seeing two really, really strong poker players here, and, you know, they played great these first games, lots of creativity, particularly from Lebedev, and, you know, I'd love to see the geezer get 3 points on the board, because, you know, he's worked his socks off, he's trying everything, pulling off river bets, four bet bluffs pre-flop. Let's see if he can finally get 3 points for the Wolverines.
Yeah, you know, a tough draw here for Lebedev, obviously after losing three straight to Nananoko last week and really just getting unlucky, so.
Yeah, still with a smile on his face. We'll see if that continues if he goes 5-0. Tim, the teddy bear Adams.
On to game two.
9-9-9.
And Sergey. Sergey. I don't know how to pronounce the name. Sergey. Nice guy, though. We just, him and I, we final tabled EPT Dublin Structure. 10K high roller.
And that's a small one.
A little while ago. This is a whitish peel, I would say.
I think.
But I assume he's betting here. Close to
rainbow.
I mean,
king 5-5.
Yeah. Interesting river. It would be a better river for me than him. But my queen high has
no way to bluff. Value.
Yeah.
So, Tim, reiterating what I was saying there about the caliber of these players, you know, in fact, that 10K high roller final table that Lebedev made, Tim was also there. You know, these guys making their way through
texture,
elite fields on a regular basis.
No flush draw, ace nine deuce. I will go small, third pot, roughly, with range. Slightly bigger if there's a flush draw. Queen 5 off his appeal.
I think I had to bad the structure. Or defend my.
These matches take a lot out of you. Like a couple weeks ago when I played Bonimo, I was telling the guys on my Rome team, we have a group chat, like a WhatsApp chat, and I was telling them how I was so wired after I played. Like, I live in Finland, and the matches start at midnight, like it did tonight, and I couldn't get to bed till like 5 in the morning after. Like, my mind was just racing.
Welcome to every day for us.
Playing, you know, if I'm playing high stakes online, I mean, it might happen if I'm deep in a live tournament or something. But yeah, just that never happens. And I don't know what it is. This is just like kind of intense, you know. You're waiting all day for your match, and then you play and you're on webcam, and yeah, it's bizarre for me. I mean, definitely out of my comfort zone, and I think it does affect I mean, I'm sure it affects most of the guys the way they play.
Sometimes bluff forever. Whatever.
Yeah, it's just a little weird. And also I'm like not really used to even people like friends or something over my shoulder watching me play, you know. I prefer that they don't, just because it throws me off. So this is kind of like that, but I'm sure I'll get used
to
it.
Poor Tim.
It's not so bad.
He's such a cutie, isn't he?
I have a bit of problem mumbling when I speak, so.
Oh no.
When I rewatched the match against Justin, I was like, you know,
I just want to be there to give
just
him a
like,
hug,
wow.
Don't you?
No one can hear what I'm saying because I don't speak clearly.
I miss Timmy. He's the best.
A lot of equity.
My girlfriend is giving me a hard time about that.
Oh, the hearts shatter
my
over
whole
Twitch
life, my
chat.
My mom's been giving me a hard time about that, about how I don't speak
and he's a mama's
clearly.
Boy.
Yeah, I can bet this turn for sure. I kind of would have preferred to. I'm now rambling and probably losing concentration. but yeah. Weird sizing. Okay. Call and reevaluate.
Pretty weak line from him. He bet two big bets against Panama. So we'll try to bluff here.
Sergey suggesting he has watched Tim's earlier match and taken some notes on his tendencies.
Wow. I mean, with this, he is repping Queen X that he checked back on the flop. Flush draw that he checked back on the flop. But it just seems like he has a lot of 10x, 9x with a heart. This is a big bet, though. In these scenarios, you could go either way with having a heart. You'd expect him to c-bet most of his flush draws on the flop. When I say you can go either way with a heart, is you prefer him to have, you know, like one heart in his hand, because it'll be necessary for him to like have the heart in his hand to bluff with the size. Yeah, I don't know. I'm just gonna call.
Tim Adams, off to a great start here in the second match.
Not so often against him.
I mean,
he's in hair call mood.
Fairly quick, but then I just started talking about it. But, yeah, I wasn't really considering folding. Sometimes I have a hard time typing in the bets.
No value in the race.
Kind of messes with my timing. I'm like tanking and then betting. I just feel so weak.
Both players turn a flush, but a pretty low one. Flush.
For our hand. Now we are going to check and see what happens on the river.
Interesting to see whether Sergey goes
thin value. A lot of value in bet, and he can bluff some.
A lot of his like bluffs, river bluffs, have now made a pair. This is pretty close between a value bet and a non-value bet.
Tim Adams does have the worst hand here: 4 high flush against 7 high flush.
Can bluff against prior. I don't think he'll value bet flush lower than mine.
But he does do that. Sergey snapping it off.
It was a little thin.
And a nice pot for Sergey Lebedev.
Just a little. But only half pot. I think he would be in a difficult spot with two pairs, and with that river, he makes, you know, some straights. If he peels them on the flop.
Good enough. Calling flop. So small.
If he peels them on the flop without a straight, that's the point I was trying to make.
Bad turn. So just hoping he will check, slow it down. Don't think I will bluff any river.
Tim does fire again with the gut shot. And against that part of Sergey's range, the ace high portion
of his range.
The turn
is an odd bet for me. Trying to fold out ace highs.
Yeah. Tim Adams.
I don't think I need to bet like so big. The 10 is obviously extremely valuable. Yeah, and that last match with the sixes showed me the turn. It's actually my default to definitely peel the turn. Like as a range play, but
ding ding ding.
But yeah, like big respect to Lebedev for folding. Maybe I wasn't giving him enough respect by making that shove.
Bad news for Sergey Lebedev as he does river a pair, outdrawing Tim Adams' fives and threes.
Hmm. Our bluffs. There are some. Seven, six is the one that comes to mind.
Very value betty looking sizing here from Tim Adams. It's a bold move, Cotton. Let's see if it pays off.
Have a little bet and five here.
Yeah, Sergey very aware that when he checks back the turn.
I was thinking about overbetting this river, but.
Okay, should call.
Just think a little bit like ridiculously strong, obviously. Well, for many reasons. But yeah, I think I like that.
Sergey getting sticky and Tim Adams scooping in another
just, yeah,
nice
I
pot.
I haven't really like employed that yet into my strategy. And I think the first time there it looks rather strong.
I think on flop, like usual. I don't think it's good enough for calling flop.
I'm going to see bet the ace 9.
More than usual.
Sorry, well, lost my train of thought. I decided to see bet that board. It's just good to have them fold out like a hand like Jack 7 suited.
Interesting there, because Sergey did have Jack 7 off.
Yeah, and obviously a very uncoordinated board.
Another catching top pair, but it's a flush board.
Sergey limp calling the ace high here. And
it's
worked out well for him so far. Starts by flopping top pair. Tim probably going to not think he has too many ace-x in his limp peeling range.
Better now.
Going to feel like it's more likely he has a 9-10, 9-8 type of combo.
We're going to check this turn. I mean, we just have so many better semi-bluffs to bet with. You know, like... This is one of the weaker draws I have to see bet with on the flop. I think it's a pretty easy fold on the turn. Obviously. See, I'm new to this camera thing. Just mumbling.
Tim Adams has been very generous in sharing his thoughts with us. Been a feature of these first 3 weeks at the GPL. So many top poker minds, you know, obviously signed up to compete in the GPL. But another component being engagement with fans, providing poker as entertainment. And it's fantastic that Tim and others are embracing that. Sergey as well, of course, struggling. you know, not his native language, a natural Russian speaker, sharing some thoughts with the Russian audience in his native tongue and having to translate while playing high-level poker. Real generosity from these guys. It is worth remembering. And
I don't c-bet all my middle pairs. I like to keep the frequency fairly balanced. But I've been c-betting quite a lot on these kind of boards, and just going to continue. This is close between a check and a bet.
Amazing if Tim can get value on the turn here, because that would be a hand Sergey would call with.
And ace also.
Looks like Sergey's like checking the river.
Has ace.
Now we should
call it a bet. Sometimes I have king high and he will try to bluff me.
Sergey running into it time and time again.
Checking turn.
Tim Adams.
Some good fives. Okay, should call.
Tim Adams getting value there with second pair, Jack Kicker and Sergey Lebedev. Not running good here against top class opposition.
Yeah, Lebedev just really not able to get anything going in the in the first two matches downs here.
You can see
Tim Adams so tough.
The bottom of your corner, Tim Adams, 1-0 up already. Already secured 3 points for the Rome Emperors. Outdrawing queens with King Jack suited on the river, all in pre-flop. So some run good already for the Rome Emperors representative.
The Rome Rofflers.
The Rome Rofflers, mate. Tim Adams isn't a Roffler, though.
No, he's not.
Not quite a Roffler.
I don't know. Do you think he's ever rolled on the floor and laughed? Like, I've heard the guy laugh, but I don't know if he's, like, hit that level of roffling. Like, I've done a full roffle. Like, you maybe roffled the other day when we were making up those team names, yeah? Do you remember that? I was literally rolling on the floor. Pure, like, Homer
obviously
Simpson.
Obviously, you know, everyone knows that you have rolled on the floor laughing.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, in a very literal way.
Yeah, yeah. Have you? You probably.
I probably have.
Yeah, half a dozen times, maybe?
Yeah, a couple of times I've literally roffled. Tim Adams taking this hand to bluff with preflop, pick up the pot.
How many times do you think you've LMFAO'd? Like when you were laughing so much that your ass was just like you're laughing it off.
Not often.
Not often?
Not in any conversation I've had with you, mate.
No? You don't think so?
Sorry, bruv. No.
Well, if I ever see your ass leave you, I know I've done some good work.
Sergey, taking a slightly lower variance route, and bingo, bango, bongo.
I'm just burying my strategy with the opens now.
Tim Adams is feeling really good about flopping top two pair here with his opponent down to 12 big blinds. But Sergey Lebedev has smashed this flop.
He bets the structure. He often have something because I catch this part so often.
Yeah, Sergey, with a correct analysis, Tim wouldn't be c-betting this board wide. Tim does have a very strong value hand, but right now he only has 17% equity. Only 17% of the time he will win this
hand.
I know
this looks strong, but he has a hand. I don't think he can lay.
Tim, fold to jack 8. Come on, mate.
Fold it here. Extremely short. Yeah.
Bit of a cooler.
Here's Jack. Johnny.
Okay.
Wrong board pair. Then is okay.
Wrong board pairing card.
Sergey Lebedev, big double up to over 20 big blinds.
Yeah, he bluffed me.
Right back in it.
Three of spades. Before.
Okay. Nice here. And this match very delicately balanced. With the blind so high, not hard to overcome this kind of chip deficit. Obviously, it's hard against Tim Adams, but in general, we have seen, you know, these chip stacks swinging back and forth at this kind of blind level. sure what Tim's tanking about here. Perhaps thinking of using this blocker to put in a 3-bet.
Not though, anything.
No snap fault from Sergey.
On fault.
He does eventually release. Right moment there from Tim Adams. This is the third. Oh, wow. This is going to be interesting if Tim elects to raise. Sergey has been keeping his variance a little bit lower by calling preflop. It's
a little bit more than 20 BBs.
With hands
he
like this.
He likes to trap with strong hands.
Yeah. So. Oh, wow. And Tim Adams in a dominating position.
Ace. One time.
Hearts or
Ten
an ace.
Hearts. Apple.
Brick on the turn. Tim Adams, one card away from a second win.
Apple.
One time.
One time. For Russia.
Really dramatic.
This is like TD poker.
I have a chance.
Huge river. I wasn't expecting that. Sergey Lebedev.
Action rivers and action turns.
Sergey Lebedev with a now 3-1 chip lead almost over Tim Adams. It's Tim Adams really under pressure with just 15 big blinds and
don't like raise the size of stacks, but hand is pretty good.
And this is what I was talking about 3xing versus these limps, attacking these limps. Tim, I think with a good strategy, when Sergey's not shoving, limp shoving a hand as strong as a suited
not
king,
now. Good now.
I think this is going to be very profitable from the Rome Broffler, Tim Adams. And 2-1, the chip lead of Sergey Lebedev. If Tim goes for it again before the 10-minute delay, show Sergey his strategy. Yeah, look at this. Really
yeah,
like this.
I'm just like sticking to my strategy here with my. I'm just sticking to my strategy.
Should defend. Carries.
Really like that from Tim. Taking his lowest equity hands. And raising.
I'm gonna mix in a limp. I've been raising very often.
Tim Adams turning bottom pair. Sergey Lebedev now with a straight.
He has some fans. He can bluff. Now we're bad.
This will be interesting on the river. Wow, for some reason, I really think he just has it. I think he just dabs the turns.
No race. Please.
This might be ridiculous. The option to raise is there with the ace of hearts. I'm just going to make quite a tight fold.
Big fold from Tim Adams. Please correct.
Finally, good hand. Try to.
Big old in here. Lebedev, a lot of things to fade here.
Kind of hurts toward the for fans.
Great card for him now.
First win.
Sergey Lebedev.
Congratulations. Going to win. Third one.
Big
see you.
Comeback in this match. Sergey Lebedev, 3 points for the Moscow Wolverines.
You know, we've had a lot of great celebrations over the course of the GPL, obviously. We have the Kitty Kuo Selly. We had the Liv Selly, which is classic. We had the Tricket, just not even flinching. But Sergey Lebedev congratulating himself, is that's my personal favorite.
Yeah, great stuff for Sergey.
Congratulations.
He did it with a smile on his face all the way through. Obviously, it can't be easy. As Tim was pointing out there when he, you know, opened by telling us so much about his first match, these guys used to playing the highest stakes in the world, many of them unruffled by losing, a 20K pot.
Unruffled?
Or 50K pot, making a huge final table, but not used to being, in the spotlight, having a webcam, explaining their thoughts. This is something they're not contracted to do. They're obligated to play the games for their franchises, but, they want to help, create a poker fan base and such like, and we really appreciate that. And particularly for someone like Sergey Lebedev, where English not his first language, for him to share his thoughts, playing a high level match, still interacting with us, and doing it in such great cheer, from Tim and Sergey, we really appreciate that. And Sergey didn't get the rub of the green, hung on, got a huge river card, A7 against pocket sevens, and capitalized on it to get 3 points for the Wolverines.
Yeah, I mean, Sergey, obviously someone who a lot of things haven't gone his way in the first four matches. Coming into this one, he had that big chip deficit. He got it in bad. But, that's what positive energy does. And I wanted it to happen. And you guys at home wanted it to happen. And Tim Adams is not up 2-0. And Sergey Lebedev is doing it for the Moscow Wolverines.
Yeah, absolutely massive, as you say. Rome Emperors, we should remind you guys, without a win in a heads-up format or the six-max format, Tim Adams will be, with one card away from it.
Yeah.
Of putting up the first win on the board for the Rome Emperors, making franchise history here at the GPL, but couldn't do it. Now all to play for in this third game.
Yeah, and Tim Adams, that's someone who we haven't talked a ton about, but it was a very interesting selection by the Rome Emperors because they were mostly local, going with Mustafa Kinnit, Dario Sammartino, you got Max Pescatori, Walter Chikari. And then Tim Adams is kind of this weird sort of selection that is just such a great thing for that team because he's, that's just them being okay, who's the best player in the player pool? And for them, it was Tim Adams, and I think that we've really seen that. Now let's go to the lounge because Laura and Eric, they want to talk to you guys. They've been bugging me for the last minute, so there they are.
Oh, we're bucking so bad. We just want to talk to you too. Right, let's talk about that last game because Sergey Lebedev has made it 1-all, 3-all now. Who's going to take the decider?
No clue. It was supposed to be a win for Tim Adams. That didn't happen.
I know.
The poor emperors are still not on the board. They were right there until the end. So, yeah, no clue. Moscow, we know that Moscow will finish the night third. We know that. Other than that, we have no clue what's going to happen in this match. Two very good competitors, but they're playing really well.
Yeah, that was another very swingy game, wasn't it? Always when we see these, Lebedev especially, it seems to be very, it was swingy with when he played Nietzsche as well, right?
Yeah,
sorry, that was Tarnowski.
They don't talk a lot, but they're very intriguing, actually, both of them. When they do talk, it's fun to see them go through the hands and stuff. So, yeah, it's actually a match that I wasn't necessarily expecting to like that much, but it's really turning out to be a great match.
Yeah, and obviously we've talked about how it might affect the points going forward. Moscow will stay in third place.
Yeah,
is
they will absolutely
confirmed?
Finish third after tonight, which is, I think, a good spot for them. So win or lose off, obviously they want those extra 3 points to reach closer to the top, but they'll be happy with that.
But Rome could overtake London.
As the camera's no longer on me, I'll check. Yes.
It's so okay. Rome we don't expect you to know everything.
Yeah, it's been a long week already. So Rome would overtake London. So London would actually be out of a playoff spot if the playoffs started tonight. should Rome get their first ever win tonight.
But the playoffs are not starting tonight, no. So that's okay. When are the playoffs happening?
In a long time from now. September is what we're looking at.
We don't need to worry about
that. So yeah, a long time from now.
We haven't shown our little structure of the GPL video for a while, so maybe we should just talk a little bit about how the online action leads to the live action. We're into week three here. Mm-hmm. It's going so quickly, I have to say.
It is.
And we've got 8 weeks of online arena action, mm-hmm. and then we see some live stuff.
Yeah, there's two reasons to get excited about the live matches. First, they're live. They're all live from Las Vegas. They will be all live from Las Vegas throughout the summer. But the other thing to be excited about is that we're calling it the Summer Series. That's the only time you'll be able to see teams from different conferences play each other. So for all of the action in the league, you're playing against teams in your own conference, except for the Summer Series in Vegas, where you're actually playing one of the teams each week from the other conference. So we'll be able to see London versus New York, for example, Paris versus Montreal, which should be a fun one. So
who do you think will be the most entertaining pairing? Heads
well,
up.
I mean, I have no clue who's going to play each other.
It's
who's going to play
be
who?
Jungle Man with someone.
Maybe Jungle Man, although Jungle Man hasn't spent much time at the World Series, so I don't know if we'll see Jungle Man at the World Series. I think it's whoever plays Aaron Paul. It's as easy as that.
Yeah.
I think all eyes will be on Aaron Paul, and he will be playing a heads-up live match. So I think all eyes will be on him. I think he'll be very nervous. It'll be fun to see his opponent, to see if his opponent can take advantage of that and maybe put on a show. How about a Nana Noko versus Aaron Paul? That could be fun.
That could be really good. I think it's going to be really interesting, especially with him playing for LA Sunset, seeing how much training he's going to get from the players on his team. We know Olivier Bousquet will probably be a very good teacher, but there are some great players on LA Sunset's team.
Yeah, of course. I think any one of those players will be able to help him out a lot. As you mentioned, when it comes to heads-up play, I don't think they get any better than Bousquet. But we talk about Maria Ho, who's got, I think it's almost 10 years of experience now. You know, for such a young lady, it's pretty amazing that she's been around for so long. And all those players. Chance Cornuth, it's hard not to learn from this guy, who's just final tabled another WPT event. He is just on fire. The past 6-7 months have been the best time of his career. He just got married, and things really picking up for Chance Cornuth, for a man that's now in his 30s or close to them. It's been a good life, and it just continues to be a good life. So learning from Chance, how to deal with the fact that you're so hot, how do you deal with that, and making sure that continues. I think it'll be interesting to see how Maria sets up that training for him.
Do you think Aaron will teach any of the LA Sunset players anything? Do you think it's like a two-way thing?
Maybe
might give them an acting masterclass.
Well, I think on how to act on camera and maybe how to, maybe to even improve on their bluffs. Why not? But I think the teaching will come from the poker players in this situation for the most
probably.
Part.
Probably. Well, if it's going to be an exciting time anyway to see Aaron Paul and to hopefully meet him at some point.
Yeah, it should be a great time.
Yeah. Get all of your questions, comments, anything you want into us, obviously on Twitter at GPL, hashtag GPL as well. Anatoly Filatov tweeted a little earlier. He was a little bit annoyed at the first game that happened between Lebedev there. But obviously, I believe happy after that second game because it is now 3-3. Timothy Adams for Rome Empress on 3 points for this evening, giving them some much needed points. And now Lebedev on 3 points as well. This is the third and final game of this final match on a Wednesday evening. Who's it going to be, though? Is it going to be Moscow or is it going to be Rome? Over to you, boys.
Thanks so much, Laura. Griffin Benger, Sam Grafton. Like she said, it's 3-3. You might say it's 3v3, which would really make a cool form of poker one day.
Allegedly.
Allegedly. Go ahead.
Yeah, so Sergey Lebedev coming back, winning his first match, finally, after 5 attempts. Big smile on his face. Big smile going to be on the face of his manager, Anatoly Filatov, and all Moscow Wolverines fans. Tim Adams playing very, very well as well. Getting used to this format, as we said, getting used to the webcam. You know, so much more talking from him, and we really, really appreciate that. Those little insights into his strategies and poker thought process. And, you know, lots to play for in this match. Tim Adams with the option of, you know, making history for the Rome Emperors with their first ever win. And, you know, Sergey Lebedev with the opportunity to put 6 points on the board for the Moscow Wolverines and continue their push in the Eurasia Conference.
Yeah, we talk a lot about, you know, variance within these things and how, you know, the standings don't necessarily, and this is, you know, the same thing in sports, really.
It's all luck, basically. It's well, a no, but I mean, anyone can win $1 million.
Too soon, man. Too soon. Here we go, guys. Match three.
What did you do with that million? Have you still got much?
Huh?
How come you're living in such a rubbish flat?
Because you kicked me out of the one we were sharing together.
Yeah, well, you certainly did.
Right out the door.
And straight away, a big flop. Tim Adams with a three straight and top pair. And Sergey Lebedev, the Russian edge superstar, with a double gut shot. Gutty skanking. And this might slow things down a little bit because Sergey just outdrew a lot of Tim's range and doesn't really need to bluff now.
This is an interesting card. Hope he will check with 7 or 5.
Sergey has paid off in similar spots.
With this river, with the jack, I expect him to bet turn with better jacks, and I don't expect him to see bet the flop with ace high. From what I think, what I know about his strategy.
Tim Adams breaking it down for y'all.
Often has.
He knows what's going on.
9x type hand.
Oh. 9x type hand. Tim Adams, poker's a sport, ladies and gentlemen. Listen to this geezer. He knows what he's talking about. It's true, mate. Poker is a sport. Listen to Tim Adams, mate. You can't just come along as some washed up TV celebrity and compete in the Global Poker League unless you're Aaron Paul. He's the only one we're letting in. We've had enough. Brian Cranston, you're not coming in, bruv. We're shutting up shop. Only good poker players from now on.
Giancarlo Esposito, I'll accept.
Who's he?
He played
never
the,
heard of him.
He played the main villain guy. Sorry?
Cornelius, please. Gus we're not Frank, in the lounge. Roughly. When we're in the lounge, you're allowed to speak.
Come on.
The rest of the time.
Come
some professional.
We're
Eric
trying to
Denis,
establish
have a
that
word
the lounge
her.
Is somewhere else from the... From
the, lounge, the lounge isn't just next door. A couple
yeah,
of feet
no,
away.
Not at all.
The
no.
lounge is a whole other area. Yeah. Possibly...
Of our massive...
Yeah, possibly in Vegas or somewhere.
Yeah, I think it's in L.A., actually.
So Sergey Lebedev with just king high with a gut shot. Sergey Lebedev. Can you say it with Russian? Lebedev.
Lebedev.
Lebedev. Sergey Lebedev.
Sergey. Sergey Lebedev.
Timothy Adams.
Timothy
Adams. Adams.
Adams.
Timotai. Betting for value here on the turn.
Give it to a straight out. Yeah.
He's going to say, I put him on some king.
I put him on like a king eight, perhaps a suited combination. I'm thinking
never,
black clubs, maybe spades.
House, which might be obvious to most people.
Sorry, I talked over you there, Tim. Recap us.
I'm quite sure he threw about ace jack pre. Yeah, let's try to get this last game in and let's try to win. Let's try to win for. For Italy.
For the Rome Rofflers. The Rome Rampages.
I mean, you got to start asking yourself, like, what is Tim Adams really, like, want?
See that half pot.
What does he want to identify with? I mean, he's supposed to be Canadian. He's living in Finland, and he's representing the Rome Emperors. It's like, get it together, mate.
Mate.
There was a couple different sizes.
If there was a Finland Empress, Helsinki Empress.
Yeah.
That'd be pretty boss.
Interesting turn.
Be good Omaha.
Nine or
he's going to perceive us to be...
You know
what
would be really
like
meta? The Helsinki Sharks. It's like shark fins.
It's nice that we don't block a king.
That's pretty good. If anyone out there is Finnish and wants to pitch to us here at the GPL to be an expansion team. The Helsinki Sharks is super meta, and I'm going to push it through.
Queen 9.
Maybe I should raise here.
But
turn.
Yeah, it's just nice with bluff. This combo to size up, I think.
Wow, Sergey!
Yeah, not blocking the king, which is great.
Quite often, third a good hand.
Always going to call the turn with the king.
Really interesting strategy here from Sergey, suggesting he's going to raise. Oh no, he does just call in the end.
Start bluffing. This kind of run out.
And let's see if Tim can go for value.
Fault. Interesting. River bad.
I mean, we never get raised on this river, I don't think. Or, yeah, I mean, he can have queen 9. But, yeah. Interesting.
Her barrels.
And it gets there.
Didn't see it against Dustin. Don't like his size.
I expect when he has... I mean, and the thing is, he defends every king pre, one way or another. So he's king deuce, king 3, king 4, king 5.
Big bluff.
King 8, king 9. That makes up quite a lot of combos.
We'll see in 10 minutes.
Which, yeah.
Sergey finds the fold on the river, showing his class once again. Tim Adams getting two decent streets of value, though, and as with the other two matches, into an early lead. Well, in fact, as with the second match, the first match, I think Sergey had the better of the early running. You can see in the bottom of your screen, if you're just joining us, Tim Adams won the first game for 3 points. Sergey Lebedev.
All catching at all in deep stacks. Only when we are going to short stacks. Only then I'm starting to catch anything.
Yeah, the slider.
It's hard to play with nothing each time. Or with second best.
Yeah, Sergey. Reiterating a point we've made many times, obviously card distribution a huge factor in who wins these matches.
With the king jack.
Sergey getting the second best of it a lot of the time. Obviously I had lots of out against Tim's 10-6 with the queen jack. Didn't come and forced to fold the river.
I think it just works really nicely. It's going to be interesting when we presumably get shallow now that he's kind of seen what I've been doing. With my very low equity hands. And yeah.
Dude, I don't like to fold big blind, but 9-3 off, 5 deuce off.
Sergey reiterating how important it is to be defending your big blind so you don't just get run over in these heads-up matches with a ante out there. Obviously, if you're not defending a wide range of holdings, your opponent can just min-raise and pick up so many pots pre-flop. Very hard to overcome that advantage. That's why you see, again and again, in these heads-up matches, people defending 5-6 offsuit, every ace, every king, every queen. And such like might seem unusual to you guys, newer to poker. And here, Sergey does get the stronger flop. It's a very strong hand, top pair and the gut shot. And you're gonna see the same situation on the flop. Again, if you're folding to every c-bet, when you don't make a pair, you're gonna also concede so many small pots, it's gonna be hard to overcome. So probably going to see Tim Adams call with the king high.
He
misclicked there, I think it was.
I misclicked there.
Yeah, was planning to call with the king high. Okay. As it was, great for him. Because had very little chance of winning.
I was going to call. Not raise, but yeah.
I think I can call one time.
Still panicking use of the software. The software is quite easy. I don't want to bash it. It's good. It's just sometimes hard typing into the bets.
Checked a lot of missed hands.
You get kind of spoiled sometimes with the star software.
So Tim Adams checks back second pair. Probably going to go for some value here on the turn.
Bet less, maybe I'll raise him. Not like call turn with king high.
Plan was to bet turn, bet river on most rivers. I've been pretty like straightforward with my bet sizing. I'm just kind of like sticking to playing like just strong fundamentals, I guess, and not trying to like overcomplicate things. But obviously I have that in my, I guess, arsenal. But yeah, I feel pretty comfortable playing this style as well. He hasn't limped at the stack depth yet.
Bingo, bango, bongo. Is that what Mike, when does he say that? I've never watched enough of BPT. When Mike Sexton says bingo, bango, bongo, what does it mean?
It means that...
does it mean like boom, a big flop?
I mean, doesn't it feel right?
It feels good.
It feels a little too right, yeah.
It feels like three sixes is a bingo, bango, bongo.
Yeah, definitely.
Do tweet into me if you know, if you're a fan of the great Mike Sexton, who we're doing... a slightly shoddy impression of here.
As a matter of fact, if you could actually personally reach out to Mike Sexton on Twitter and ask him for us through that chain, that would be great.
No,
yeah, Mike Sexton, if you're watching, tune in, do tweet to us.
Here.
Tim just picking call. A bad spot to bluff right here.
Bluffs.
The chair. Interesting.
I actually wasn't expecting that. That's why I was talking to you. I didn't think Tim was going to attack this board. But I guess he thinks Sergey doesn't limp many 6x. That Tim checks the majority of his 6x, so he can go after this board. And now he turns a gut shot. He's going to be tempted to follow through with this bluff, I would imagine. And a very fortuitous set of events for this random limp of basics off.
Continue repping
call
six.
Call bank.
Especially on this card.
Has something like
some equity.
7, 6, 8, 6.
Which, yeah, I don't know what to make of his limp three. Can certainly have some successes in there.
Backdoor flush.
Wow.
Don't think I will raise him now. Of course, I will call any bet.
And the reason he would call any bet, obviously, is because, you know, Timothy Adams, if he's repping, if he has what he's actually repping, which most of the time he doesn't have, since Sergey has the six, you know, he would value shove. He has would have a much would have a worse six than the ace six.
To the bluff, so probably it will fold. He strips after my raise.
Tim Adams somehow arriving at the river with 8-4 high.
I think this run out, we just have to.
Oh,
we have to bluff.
It is 6-9.
Yeah, here's a 6.
8-4, which is rather good also.
I didn't feel great about that, but...
And Tim Adams with a big
just
list.
Just felt like it's kind of necessary.
Yeah, important not to be results-oriented, obviously. You know, it's one of those situations where...
his jack X on the river are...
tough calls.
Like, he gets to the river with jack X a bunch, and... he's in just, like, a ridiculous spot.
Here. That still rocks. There. Not success. Bluff.
If you're just joining us, this is the third and final match of the day. Earlier we saw Randy Liu of the Hong Kong Stars defeating Daniel Cates. 2-1, 6 points there for his franchise. Then we saw George Danza making his debut, picking up 9 points for the Paris Aviators against Igor Kurganov of the London Royals. And here, one game apiece, Tim Adams, a high-stakes cash game player from Canada, representing the Rome Emperors, and Sergey Lebedev for the Moscow Wolverines. And he's limped in with the pocket nines. But Tim Adams, completely dominated pre-flop, has flopped some equity.
No more putting money in this hand.
So Sergey checks back. And he will have a pretty decent bluff catcher on the river. Tim Adams.
Draws.
With just 9 high.
Fault anyway.
And Sergey immediately releases. And Tim Adams gets it through.
Yeah, I mean, the 8-4 bluff is like... Obviously, I would prefer to do it with backdoor flush draw, but I had a couple backdoor shit draws, and...
Side GPL studio, I'm... They can't hear me.
What the hell? So, I can't bet.
Nothing good for my pair of threes
here. Top pot here. Just to protect my hand, and also as a range play. Just because the deuce is quite good for me.
Blinds are going up. 30 big blinds about.
Always an interesting level, the 600, 1200, Sam.
Mate, super interesting.
When it comes to levels
one of my
in the GPL,
levels. One of my favorite levels.
I mean, the 612 is just riveting
great
television.
Great stuff. Love me a bit of 612.
A little trick raise here.
I could have bet flop. But it's pretty nice to jump as well.
Probably I should.
Wow, the river is.
What I should to do here, to be truth. he has some queens and he can bluff because he can't beat the board. He has nothing. So I think check call is better than trying to catch something. Because if I bet. He raised, for example, it's a problem.
To obviously get him off the chop. Just seemed like the right play.
Ones earlier today, you know, slouches. And it's a great decision. Sure. These two are obviously.
The 7-8.
Tim Adams defending his limp.
We'll check. Don't have value 3 straights.
Really interesting that Tim stabs here with the 7-8. I guess he feels that like his limp call range is perceived to really connect with this board.
I decided that the card,
but
7-8.
Sometimes he will slow down something like 8-9 and check.
The fact that it's pretty good for my limp calling range.
Probably I should fold right here if you bet.
I was planning on.
Don't think. It's a lot of bluffs here.
Sergey Lebedev, spot on there, saying that the part of his range that didn't already connect with the board, 8-9, 8-7, is going to hit that 8 and check behind. And if Tim did bet, he would have folded.
Maybe I have thin value here, but he has some queens. Not a lot of 10s because I had 10 and probably he would fold 8.
Lebedev
so
being
check.
A great sport. Speaking in English for us here.
He has like ace jack.
Really smart.
Showdown. Okay.
Sergey Lebedev's analysis spot on.
Jack.
And Tim Adams now very short, down to 15 big blinds. Sergey Lebedev in a hugely commanding spot.
They're going to call in. They remember his strategy.
Shawnee18 on Twitch has asked, why are clubs green and diamonds blue? Well, it was requested. We're doing it for you.
But still sticking with the strategy. I can't do it with every single combo, but...
Yeah. Sergey, aware that Tim has been opting to raise the weakest hands that he's dealt.
I can't do it every single combo. Obviously, there's just infinite combos of like 6-2, 9-3, 8-3. But yeah.
And if Tim, if Sergey shoves, I think he ups the limp.
Limp fold. Has 15 big blinds exactly.
You know, and of course Tim does seem short, limp calling obviously here with the king jack. But you know, if he doubles up, he's back to even, and that's just the you know, the crazy swings of this GPL.
When the crazy swings.
It's just crazy, and you know what? I know I told you that I like the 6-12 level, Sam, but have I told you how I feel about the 8-16 level?
You love it.
No, dude, we get to like 60 big blinds effective depth.
Usually
I mean, there's all in showdowns.
There's nothing.
You can have 15 big blinds total.
I have blockers
have
to any pair.
That shove with nothing
so,
on the flop in a single raise pot.
Because
do you remember
he
what
knows
I'm
that
talking about?
Bluff forever sometimes.
You remember. The North remembers.
And sometimes probably catched 7. Or he can call us with ace high, maybe king high also.
King jack high. This is decently close.
Very strong fold from Tim Adams. Getting away from the king high.
A3.
I'm all in. You get a pocket rocket's a ticket. If you got what it takes and you can play high stakes. Boom, boom, boom. I'm all in. Big high stakes fan, Samuel?
Yeah, of course. That's what we're all imitating, isn't it? That's what we're chasing after, the legends. What was it, AJ Danza? AJ? AJ Benza.
No, but I wasn't a Benza guy. That was after my time. I was more like the original.
No, he was on from the original.
Was he?
Yes.
So who's the other guy? Who's the guy?
Gabe Kaplan.
Yeah, Gabe Kaplan. We never talk about Gabe. We always joke about
Mate, I saw someone post. Here we go. Tim Adams with 8-7 suited. All in. Sergey calls with the pocket threes. Big flop.
Play later. On the three. On the river.
Tim Adams dodging two outs to double through. Improves on the river to a flush. And Tim Adams still out-chipped, but with 20 big blinds, a bit more room to maneuver, although the blinds are going up in 3 seconds.
And have I told you about how I feel about the 1-2?
How's that hashtag Griffin out? Is that still trending?
What is?
Hashtag perfect Griffin out. We'll
get
that back. Guys, if
I read a personal one that someone said to Dreyfus. Just like, listen, you guys got to get rid of these guys. I favorited it, though, for him.
I don't blame them. Certainly one of us has got to go, Griff. They can't have two amateurs. They need a blend of professional amateurs.
Yeah.
So Sergey flopping strongly, but Tim with the overcard and a spade in his hand. And Sergey, really strong draw.
Don't want to bet, and probably he shoves sometimes. I have enough equity. And sometimes he will bluff when I catch something really good. Interesting card.
Tim Adams, again and again in this match, finding himself at the river with the lowest parts of his range, with
should
just the high card hands.
I think so.
He's going to go for a bluff here, and I don't think it's going to work.
Not happy with this call, the betrothed.
Sergey Lebedev, river and two pair.
Has 8, 10, 9. What else? 6. OK. Just call because we have one time. First do with river call. Success.
Much success.
And so
this is gonna be tough.
Tim might, I don't know whether this is a shove
or min call.
I think this ace nine off is a pretty good shove, but
the limb call is gonna work.
Yeah. It's definitely gonna work out in this instance. And Tim Adams is going to be all in, but with the best hand. Sergey needing a three to end it right now.
Or backdoor knockers.
Yeah, four of clubs.
Slubber langs.
Four of clubs would be a sweat. It is a club.
Six of seven.
We want to hold.
6-7-3-4 a chop. Or for a win. Oh, and the three hits for
the
win.
It's the flash. I won again.
Too bad.
Each time. First hand won. Good
nice
game.
Nice hand, Sergey. Another 3 points for the Moscow Wolverines. Two games to one, 6 points for Sergey Lebedev.
There you are, Sergey. After getting swept by Nananoko last week, he comes out here, gets two from 6 points from Tim Adams. Pretty impressive stuff from him. You know, not the most exhilarating matches we've had all week, but certainly some great strategy and a couple of hands that were very of interest.
Yeah, of course. And great stuff for Sergey Lebedev. Obviously, you know, it's so great. You know, as the weeks progress, we're going to learn more and more about these guys. And, you know, such a difference between the first week. Obviously, everyone was a little bit camera shy, as mm-hmm. it was. You know, and Sergey really joining in with the spirit of the
yeah,
GPL.
Great.
Sharing
great
so
see.
Much for, you know, so difficult when he says, I'm going to share with the fans. I'm going to speak in Russian now. You know, connecting with the Moscow Wolverines fans. Our producers come in and say, listen, we need some English from you. You know, imagine, you know, playing this high-level poker and translating into another language. Amazing stuff.
And then getting
and
6 points from one of the best players in the world.
Wonderful stuff. Rome Empress, though, still without a win in the Global Poker League.
Living up to the Rome Rofflers that we in call here on the desk.
Tim Adams, you know, was only, you'll remember, one card away from making it 2 out of 2, sevens versus A7. The ace comes on the river. How things change. And he'll be really disappointed. Two matches now from, you know, a high-stakes hero and only 6 points on the board.
Yeah, you know, not the result that Tim Adams wanted. And, of course, like you said, just one card away. That just shows you the swings. You know, like one win, one loss is a 6-point swing either way, which really shows a lot of discrepancy in the standings. Of course, we're still very early here on the GPL. This is the third week. We have another slew of heads-up matches tomorrow, a lot of really great ones to look forward to. But for now, I think we should see what Laura and Eric are up to, yeah? Are they ready for us, or should we keep going here? We're going to throw to them for a little bit. Let's talk about Sergey for a bit here. Obviously, someone that, you know, we don't know a lot about. He's someone that has been cutting his teeth in the super high. He was playing super high rollers and big buy-ins, final tabling a lot of them. You see the way that his thought process is, and he really does show that he has a high-thinking mind.
Yeah, of course. I mean, one of the things in poker is there's a skew in the reporting to the wins. You know, when you have, you know, when you pick up a big trophy, you know, and have your photo taken, plastered all over Poker News or what have you, you know, everyone hears of you. When you're getting consistent thirds, fourths, fifths, you know, you can be just as good a poker player and things just not going your way. Someone with 3 WSOP final tables and 2 high roller finals just at the last EPT in 2016 in Dublin. So, you know, an incredible background in poker, strong tournament results. Who knows how much this geezer is making in Moscow cash games? You know, could be more than the wages we're getting in here at GPL. Who knows?
Oh, that's for sure. I mean, the thing is, too, is that when you see these players that are so talented, they kind of serve as like the outlier. You look at Tony Gregg, you know, getting swept 6th and 6th in his like 6 max matches, how often that would really happen. You look at Justin Bonomo showing how good he is when he played heads up against Tim Adams in that first week, and then he plays the 6 max matches again on Tuesday. And he gets what, maybe 1 point? And that's just the way that this kind of works here at the GPL. Everyone is so good. Things need to go your way. You need to play great. Let's see Laura and Eric now as they are going to take a look at the standings. We're all done here.
Thank you so much, Sam and Griffin. That is the last of our matches, the last of our games this evening. And it goes to the Moscow Wolverines, 2-1. What do you think to that, Hay?
It was a great game. Yeah, very tight both sides, and it was a great game.
We hopefully will have the winner of that last match on Skype with us. Are you there, Sergey? We're trying to connect Mr. Lebedev right now. There he is. Oh, congratulations, Sergey, winning there. Another 6 points for the Moscow Wolverines.
Thank you very much.
Here is my wife, Dina.
Hi, Dina.
In this game, and she has much better English than me. So probably she will translate some things if I will have problems with English words.
You've played a few games now from the GPL. Are you enjoying it? And which has been your favorite so far and why?
I like this one much, much more because I won 2-1. Yes, and lose all three against Randy Liu Nananoko. He's a very strong player, but I think I should win at least one. It was really disappointing. And after I lose first one here with Queens last hand, it was unhappy for me. Yes, but finally I get some luck. And it was a really interesting game. Timothy had interesting strategies in some moments. For example, he raised a lot of very bad hands in final of second game when he was very short and I didn't expect it. So it was a nervous and interesting game.
Sergey, we've seen you in heads up action twice now. Would you say that's your specialty? Is that why we haven't seen you play some six maxes?
No, my specialty is a six max cash game. So I think that I'm playing more heads up in GPL because I have a lot of experience mm-hmm. in heads up matches also. And it is no ICM in heads up matches. Because I am cash player and I know ICM worse than tournament players and sit and go players. But I hope that I will play 6-max also because I like 6-max very much and I understood what to do in this form. Yes, in this form also. So maybe in live games I will play 6-max, maybe online also. It depends on Anatoly Filatov, our team manager.
Had you done much preparation before this match with Timothy Adams? Had you watched him play? Did he play how you expected him to play?
I watched his play against Justin. And Justin was a little more lucky in this game. But also, I think that his aggression worked. So I decided to play quite aggressive, yes. In the very first hand, I raised the river. Maybe I had the best hand, but I don't think so. I didn't see it. Then I forbade him with 6-4 because I knew that he will forbade me light. When I played first game, it was unusual for me. I'm not a streamer player, I didn't saw cards of Randy. This time I put a second laptop near me and saw all hands. So and I tried to be more communicative, but it is still hard for me. I hope I will do my best next matches.
No, you're great on camera. Don't even say that. One person that is fantastic on camera is your team manager, Anatoly Filatov. Talk to me a bit about Anatoly. How does the strategy work? Do you guys talk a lot about the upcoming matches?
Yes, we have a lot of discussions in our Skype group and WhatsApp group also. Sometimes we are not agree each other. But always it is respect of opinion, because we have different ages, different styles, different experience. Yes, but I think we all are respecting each other. So it's only advices and not like, what are you doing, man?
Yeah. Thank you so much for chatting with us, Sergey, and your beautiful wife as well. We wish you all the best of luck in the next GPL matches you play. Thanks.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Sergey Lebedev there, winning 6 points for the Moscow Wolverines, making Anatoly Filatov a very happy manager. We're going to go back to the desk now, back to Griffin and to Sam, for some key hand reviews.
Key hand reviews. Griffin Benger, Sam Grafton. Let's jump right into it. Sergey Lebedev, Tim Adams, 2-1 in favor of Lebedev. 6 points for the Moscow Wolverines. The Rome Emperors still with that slow start so far. But what were some of the key hands for you? Shall we take a look?
Well, I don't know about hands. I don't know. Normally it's just a key hand. But yeah, I think we do have a hand to look through. And it was the third match. Obviously, so much to play for in terms of pride and 3 points. And this was a real key turning point. This hand about to come up. Sergey Lebedev pretty unexpectedly chose to limp in with, this isn't the hand. well, I'm sure we'll have it for you in a moment.
No, I requested the 9-deuce-10-4, I believe. He limps and then maybe it's check down.
But, you know, just to recap, if you, Sergey Lebedev roguely limped in with A6 offsuit. I'll have it for you in a moment. Pretty unusual. A little bit. It shows how, one of the things I keep saying is about some of the guys doing things just by feel, just sort of randomizing. But that's very hard to play against. And he randomly limped in with the A6 off and flopped 3 sixes. Tim Adams on Jack 6-6, 8-4 off, had absolutely nothing, no backdoor flush. But when Sergey bet out, Tim kind of felt that he was the one with more sixes in his range.
Right.
He perhaps expected a limp from a hand like 10-9 suited, Queen 10, 9-8 suited. Those are the sort of hands that people pick to limp in at that stack depth because they don't want to be, they can't peel a 3-bet and they don't want to be blown off their hand.
Right.
So he didn't really think he'd be limping a hand as weak as 6-5 or as good as A6. And, you know, that's understandable because, as I said, it was a little bit of a random choice. So Tim Adams check-raised the 8-4 off. I'm sure maybe we'll have it in a minute.
The flop story, was Jack-6-6, rainbow.
Story time with Sam Grafton.
Rainbow.
Once upon a time, Sergey Lebedev limped in with A6.
Check back from Timothy Adams with the 8-4, as you can't see here on the screen. And then a check-raise on the Jack-6-6, rainbow, Tim Adams.
He check-raised. Turn was a 5, and at this point, Tim Adams turning a gut shot. He said afterwards he felt compelled to barrel this, because obviously with 8-4 off, there's very few hands. You can turn a pair, or you can turn a gut shot. That's all that can happen. So on this card, he felt he could barrel, put pressure on. Maybe Sergey's going to have an ace high with a backdoor flush draw. Maybe he's going to have a queen 10 for a 3-straight and a backdoor flush
draw. Now, here's really when things get interesting on the river.
on the river. Yeah. So
backdoor spades did
backdoor
come.
Backdoor spades came in. And, now Tim Adams was really, on the turn, he's targeting the ace high, king high, queen high portion of Lebedev's range. Maybe a small pair like pocket twos or pocket threes. On the river, he's putting real pressure on some of the strongest parts of his range. Had Sergey limped aces for some reason, had Sergey limped Jack 10 and had a decently strong top pair. These hands are under a lot of pressure. Tim representing either a backdoor flush, mainly just a strong six. And Sergey tanked for a while. He always knew he was going to call, felt he couldn't raise, and snapped him off. And, a little bit of a misstep from Tim Adams. In general, he's someone that plays very solid ranges, doesn't do anything randomly and unmotivatedly, normally always picking hands with some kind of backdoor equity. Here, stepped really out of line, big misstep, and it really swung the match in favor of Sergey Lebedev.
Were there any other particular hands you remember every single excruciating detail you'd like to go over?
Mate, I'm just memory man.
I think we're going to sign off here for the evening.
Mate,
it was a great day of matches.
We're going to go grab some beers.
Hey, listen, we owe you guys.
If you're in Malta,
we owe you guys a replay tomorrow.
Maybe
we're
two.
Don't set the bar too high.
Okay. Possibly two.
Seriously, though, guys, thanks for tuning in with us. It's been almost 3 weeks. Sam and I are so thrilled to be here. It's gone really smoothly this week, I think.
Reasonably
smoothly. We're keeping you on your toes with little technical difficulties like this. Again, we really enjoy having you guys. We really enjoy doing this.
Yeah.
The poker's been fun. And tomorrow, another bunch of great matches. I don't know what they are yet. I need to do prep because I'm exhausted. But thanks for all
this,
guys.
But the guys in the lounge, we'll fill you in on what's happening tomorrow. Stay tuned. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the GPL. It's always fun. It's always exciting. There's always poker.
He's over Sam Grafton.
Over to the
I'm
guys in the lounge.
Griffin Benger? Who put a question mark on the teleprompter? Lounge.
Hogging all the limelight there, Griffin Benger and Sam Grafton. Come on. So, standings. Eurasian Conference, Moscow Wolverines, 6 points to them in that last match, 3 points to the Rome Emperors. Rome near the bottom, still not quite at the bottom with Berlin.
Yeah, but it's points, right? It's points, you know, they played really well. It's 3 points, it's fine. I think Tim Adams is going to be disappointed. He's 2-4 in these matches, yet he's played really well both of his matches. So, you know, I think it's points, right? They're at 27. They're 5 clear of Berlin, that's fine. Just one back of London. London really starting to disappoint at this time. Yeah. 12 points behind Paris, who leads the way. Hong Kong just keeps on defying the odds, right?
Only 5 points away from the top spot, from Paris now.
And what's remarkable is that they had a really tough first week. Lebedev was signature 0 points in that first match. Had he won two of those matches, they'd be way in front of Hong Kong and just challenging Paris. So it just goes to show that you need to be consistent every single week. But Moscow starting last week with Troyanovsky, that things have really turned around. We know that Anatoly Filatov has already told us yesterday during an interview segment that he's getting into the action next week. So look for more points. Suddenly, the Wolverines are looking really good.
Yeah, the Wolverines are going to scare, I think, next week. Looking very good, especially after this last heads-up match. 6 points for Lebedev, taking the Wolverines up to third place in the standings. We've got America's Conference heads-up action for you tomorrow, though. I wonder if we can take a look at the America's Conference standings and see where we are for tomorrow, because we've got some action-packed, fun heads-up action coming for you tomorrow. New York Rounders is going to be a good game tomorrow. Obviously, we've got Bryn from New York Rounders against the Montreal Nationals. That's going to be the big one. First and second place heads-up against each other. That's the last match of the evening tomorrow.
Yeah, first place could very well be on the line. It should be on the line unless, I guess, the Sunset, even if they do sweep. It'll take a lot for the Sunset to sweep. So it looks like Montreal and New York will be playing for first place tomorrow in our featured match, our third match of the night. So that'll be exciting for sure. I'm excited to see Sao Paulo, Zhao Bauer, making his debut against Jonathan Little of Las Vegas. And those two teams are right now neck and neck. So, you know, one of those two teams will separate from that group, so it'd be interesting to see. And then L.A. San Francisco, that's never a bad rivalry. The Dodgers and the Giants.
They're very.
I know you're a big Dodgers fan, but Dodgers and Giants and MLB, that's a big rivalry.
Giants.
And then the return of the L.A. Rams, so the Rams and the fighter 49ers. So there are big rivalries.
49ers,
between LA,
I know they're San Francisco.
There you go, San Francisco.
There you go, I knew something.
Right.
So action-packed stuff coming up tomorrow. Take a look at what is coming up. Lots of debuts happening tomorrow as well. Jonathan Little, we've not seen him before. Joao Barra, they're on first. They're on at 10 a.m. Pacific time, 1 p.m. Eastern or 7 Central European time. Then we've got Eugene Kachalov. We saw him in action this week in the Six Max. He will be back for heads up against the debut of Jonathan Jaffe for the San Francisco Rush. They need points. They are bang at the bottom of the table and they are looking to climb up. That match is 29. It will be on at 12:30 Pacific, 3:30 Eastern and 9:30 Central European time. And then the match that everyone will be waiting for, because they are first and second in the America's Conference League right now, is the New York Rounders. Bryn Kenny making his debut. A lot of pressure on him after his brother Tyler played this week and put in an absolutely amazing effort. He'll be playing against Pascal Lefrancois, who also played last week and did pretty well, didn't he?
Undefeated. Lefrancois is undefeated to date. I'm excited. You know, Kachalov and Jaffe, that match is not getting as much love as it should. We're talking about two pioneers, two kingpins of poker. Both have won bracelets and EPTs and WPTs. So really, really exciting to see those two players go head-to-head tomorrow. That's going to be a spectacular match for our second match.
Having said that, so many players in the GPL that just have so many achievements behind them. Everyone was sort of selling George Danza short a little bit earlier. Like, so many achievements, played so well, didn't he, against Igor?
Yeah, but I think for Danza, we weren't cutting Danza down. It was more the opponent, Kurganov, just a star player. So, you know, no one was expecting Danza to fall flat. But no one expected him to win three in a row. I don't think George Danza expected three in a row. He was quite honest on telling us he would have been really excited to win two matches. So I think George just understood where he was at.
It was that dice.
What's that?
It was all that dice.
Right, the rolling of the dice. Apparently that's how you win poker matches against Igor Kurganov, which actually is not a terrible strategy if you're going to play Igor Kurganov.
You might as well roll a die. Well, thank you so much for watching this evening, folks. It's been a fun Wednesday evening for the Heads Up Eurasian Conference. Thank you to our commentary team, Sam and Griffin. Thank you to Eric. Thank you for watching. And we will be back here tomorrow, 1 p.m. Eastern time, for our very first match, Heads Up from the Americas Conference. Please do join us then.
Can't get enough of the GPL? Head over to globalpokerleague.com for the most complete and up-to-date standings, schedule, stats, and information on your favorite team, as well as full-length match replays, highlights, and epic hands from all of our matches, and much, much more.
We'll be right back.